Thank you very much, Wayne. Give me just a second to get set up here. All right. Okay, do we have an image over there? Awesome. All right, well, welcome, good morning. This is an extremely exciting event to be part of. I'd heard that there were these life masks of Lincoln, and we're interested in digitizing faces sometimes. There's one sitting right there. You can pick it up thanks to 3D scanning and printing technology, and it's amazing that the Smithsonian is going to be making stuff that before was behind glass, and now it can be in your hands. Wayne mentioned a little bit that this technology is, you know, related in some ways to movie making. That's fundamentally about storytelling, and that's also fundamentally a lot about what museums are. It's about telling stories and telling our own stories, telling the stories of our country, telling the stories of our of all of our efforts, stories of invention. One of the stories that I was interested in trying to tell, or at least documenting a little bit, quite a long time ago, and why I got interested in this, is that I had a particular artifact that was important to me, and for some reason I thought it needs to be preserved in the computer. And this was the car that I was driving when I was in college at the University of Michigan, which is a quite impressive vehicle, as you can see here. And I think maybe because it's not the most impressive vehicle, I thought it would be cooler to have it in the computer where you can make it fly around on the screen and do things cooler than you could normally do with it. And in order to get into the computer, I knew in order for it to feel like it was the real thing, it had to look like the real thing. And the idea I had to digitize it was not to try to, you know, manually input vertices of polygons and then paint them all gray and hope it looked like my car. But instead, I parked it next to a tall building and I took photos of it from different angles. And I wrote some software back in 1991 to reconstruct the shape of the car from the photographs. And more importantly, I took the images of the car and I projected them on to this geometry that was recorded as texture maps. And as a result, the geometry wasn't all that accurate, but the photos stuck on there kind of gave it the impression of being the real car and also made it look a lot more realistic than the geometry alone would have allowed. And so I did go ahead and make a low resolution animation of the car flying across the screen like that, which was kind of fun. I was a little lazy at the time, and so I never used a photo of the back of the car. I reused the front, and you can see the headlights are on the back as well. But that seemed like this could be actually a useful kind of piece of technology. And when I got to graduate school at the University of California at Berkeley, it was time to do something for a PhD, so how could we set the sights a little bit higher? And I looked literally higher up, and I saw the Berkeley Tower. The Campanile, which seemed like a nice piece of architecture, and I thought it would be nice to, well, maybe we can digitize that. But just seeing something isolated and not in its context wasn't going to be quite as exciting. So I thought, well, we should really digitize the rest of the campus as well. And this looked a little bit challenging, but I was in a computer vision PhD program, and it was all about taking photos, deriving models from them. And I also met a professor of architecture, Professor Chris Benton, who did kite aerial photography, and he helped figure out a way that we could get the photos from the places we needed to do a three-dimensional reconstruction. And here you can see one of our kite flights. That's Chris Benton. We did eventually get the kite up and get a camera on it. And from that, we got these photographs, kind of from the ground and from above. And I climbed up in the lantern as well, and I got some photos looking around the campus. And the PhD work that I did at Berkeley with C.J. Taylor and my advisor, Jitendra Malik, was about photogrammetry, getting 3D models out of photos. And it was a semi-automatic process. You had to mark lines in the photos. But then the computer would figure out the size and the shapes of all of the architectural geometric primitives to match them into the scene. And so you could build a model of campus like this, and when you put the textures on, it would actually start to look kind of like you were flying around the tower, even though it's relatively simple geometry. And these are some of the kind of more stable views of flying around the tower that we did. And we also made a little bit of a movie of the thing, because it looked like it was realistic enough we might be able to do some fun things of transitioning from the computer rendered imagery back to reality. So this is a scene from the film that we made. And so we're computer, now we're back to reality here. That's me actually up on top of the tower, and then we transition back to complete our camera move for that. And essentially this technology, through some consulting and some students that we did, became the virtual backgrounds in the bullet time shots in The Matrix, which was a cool way to see it actually get up and seen by a lot of people at that point. And then at that point, I got to the University of Southern California, the Institute for Creative Technologies, and we wanted to go a little bit further in digitizing environments. And the things that seemed like limitations at the time were that we were kind of stuck with relatively blocky architecture, but also we were stuck with the lighting that happened to be there. I'd intentionally taken all the photos under cloudy conditions, so we didn't have too much of an issue with dynamic range and really bright stuff or really dark stuff. So I wanted to attack these problems head on and also do something that was maybe, you know, kind of moving up from my Chevette to the Berkeley campus to something of an equal step of cultural importance there. For that we chose the Parthenon, which is, one of the, it's the main monument on the Athenian Acropolis. And it also has very complicated geometry due to all of the complexities of its history that it's had. It's been a temple, it's been a cathedral, it's been a mosque, it's been a battlefield, and it's been a touchstone for the discussion of where should artifacts live. We were very lucky that at this point, laser scanning technology had advanced quite a bit, and by working with QuantaPoint, this is John Shipley from QuantaPoint, they were able to provide a scanner that we could go out, and in a week, back in 2003, we scanned about 120 panoramic laser scans there. Many in the audience are probably familiar with this process. And you get this raw data of point clouds, and then at some point you need to assemble them into a three-dimensional polygon model, which you can see here. And anyone familiar with this process knows that many graduate students died in this process to create the actual surfaces from all of these points. But we got about a 60 million polygon model, maybe about 2 centimeters of accuracy at the time. But I wanted to create visualizations of it where we could control the lighting. We could actually visualize it under any natural illumination condition that we would want. And in order to get the appearance properties, you're pretty much stuck with taking photographs of the thing. But the problem with photographs is that they're locked into a particular kind of illumination. And so you get shadows, you get shading in these things and highlights. And if you just use this photo as a texture map, project it on, and then try to put new lighting on it, you might get doubled shadows or things look too bright or too dark. It's just not a good record of what's the reflectance of the surfaces. And for a site as large as the Parthenon, you know, you walk around it and you're getting all your photos, the light very well might change in the middle of this. So you can't even get a consistent texture map for the entire thing in some cases. So our idea to try to factor the lighting out of photos and get the real reflectance map values was that we would document the incident light on the site every time we took a photo of the Parthenon. So we had a walkie-talkie system, and every time somebody would snap a photo over here, they'd press a button, and then the person who was trying to get a little bit of shade underneath our light probe device here would fire off a lighting data set. And essentially, this has three spheres in it. It's got a mirrored sphere that reflects the sky and the clouds. It's got a black plastic sphere that gives you a pretty clear image of the direction that the sun is coming from with that little specular highlight on it. But neither of those spheres is going to record the actual intensity of the sun. It's way too bright to fall within the range of your camera in those reflections. So we have a diffuse sphere as well, and from that we can mathematically back out how much sunlight there was in addition to all the ambient light. So we get a record of the incident light coming everywhere in the sky, sun, clouds, and open sky. And then from that, we have, you know, our idea of what the geometry of the Parthenon is, which we can then light with one of these sky data sets using an image-based lighting technology. We can compare that to a real photo, and if it happened to have the right texture maps on it already, then lighting it in the same light as that photo was taken in, they should look the same. And if they don't look the same, it's showing that the texture maps that we have on it are too bright wherever this rendering is too bright, and they're too dark wherever the rendering is too dark. So you can then iterate what your texture maps are and solve for a texture map for your scene, which lit with that light looks like a photo of the thing under that light. And we're basically factoring the lighting out of the photo. And you get texture maps that don't have shading or shadows or, you know, bright on one side of the column because the sun happened to be coming from there. And then when you simulate that under new light, so this is a rendering of our Parthenon model with these recorded, recovered texture maps, you can compare it pretty directly to a photograph under the same light. And, you know, a lot of things are changing in here. We didn't model the scaffolding, and we didn't model the stones in front of the Parthenon. But you can see that actually the color of the surfaces are relatively predictive of what's happening from the rendering to the photograph. And this would be true of just any illumination condition that you would have. You could even design synthetic illumination or spotlights if you wanted to imagine it for some sort of concert to have to happen there. So it was great to have this relightable Parthenon model, and I got interested in trying to make a little short animation about it. And probably the most relevant story about it right now has to do with its sculptures and the fact that they're not on the Parthenon, and there's some discussion as to where the best place to put them would be. And we needed to get some models of the sculptures, and as it turns out, using the predecessor of 3D printing technology, there are actually casts of these sculptures, every single one of them, including the collection in the British Museum, the ones that remained in Athens, the few pieces in the Louvre, and the other fragments that you can find in Vienna and Copenhagen, in the Basel Sculpture Hall. And the director of the Basel Sculpture Hall graciously opened his museum up to us, even at night for 4 days, Thomas Lachmann, so that myself and our archaeological collaborator, Philippe Martinez from École Normale Supérieure, could, with this homebrew 3D scanner, it's a video projector and a video camera, move and get the sculptural decoration program of the Parthenon. And that, combined with some just photos that we took in the British Museum to project on as texture maps, and a little bit of photogrammetry inside there to reconstruct a model of the Duveen Gallery, we were able to create a little bit of a visualization of the Parthenon and its sculptures. So everything you see here, other than the sunrise at the beginning, is all 100% computer rendered, and the time-lapse lighting was actually recorded from the top of our institute in Marina del Rey, California, of the sky, because we didn't have time to get a full sky pass when we were in Athens, but the proximity to water, latitude, and pollution levels are about the same, so should match up. So that was a fun project to work on at USC ICT. When we get texture maps for surfaces, you know, the simplest form is just like a red, green, blue color everywhere. Even if the lighting's been factored out of it, it's still basically an RGB image that you're sticking onto the surface. And real surfaces reflect light a little bit more interestingly than that. Even the surfaces of the Parthenon, which are pretty matte diffuse overall, have a bit of interest in terms of the forward scattering, the back scatter. They're not perfectly Lambertian, you know, matte gray painted surfaces. We actually got access to the site late at night so we could get the ambient light out, and we did some reflectometry experiments, just moving a light around and some reference spheres and a reference frame, taking pictures from different directions. And when we rendered the Parthenon, we actually did try to use its natural reflectance properties for the different kinds of materials that are stuck onto it. But still, it was tractable because it was relatively diffuse. Now, real artifacts, which for those of you who came to the reception yesterday or will be over at the Smithsonian Castle later, you can see many great examples of artifacts that have much more interesting reflectance properties, which we'd also like to record and predict how they would look in different lighting conditions. The way that different surfaces reflect light and look, whether they're matte or shiny or various things in between, tell us a lot about them. They tell us, for example, very important things about what are these things made out of. We have a good sense of the item on the left was made out of certain metals, and we can even imagine what it would feel like if we ran our fingers across them, just from how it reflects the light, comparing, you know, the left to the right. Also, if you're designing museum exhibits, you might want to predict what the artifact would look like in given lighting, if you're deciding what kind of lights to get or how to arrange them. And very interesting things can happen when you have various kinds of, you know, brushed metals or anisotropic reflection. In fact, even the light that comes off of the artifact back onto the walls, as you can see here, these would be called caustic reflections in the computer graphics terminology, are interesting and are relevant to how the object is getting displayed and how it might be interpreted in that context. And the reflectance properties of surfaces, and whether they're shiny or matte or scuffed up, they actually tell you quite a bit about the history of the objects, of what these things have been through. And so the story actually gets told through an object's texture maps and reflectance properties. And we'd like to record these things if possible. And we started doing things like that at the ICT pretty early on in the history of our light stage devices, which are systems that you can put an object or artifact inside, or a person, and they'll light the object from every direction that light can come from in a relatively short period of time. And this is a Native American headdress that we were recording. This is light stage two. It has a semicircle of strobe lights, and it rotates around, and you get every lighting direction. So after about 30 seconds, you might have images of the headdress lit from every direction that light can come from. And this is a nice digital record, at least of what it looks like with a certain intensity of white light coming from every direction. But you might say now, okay, from this data set, could we predict what it would look like in some other kind of illumination? And real lighting environments actually have different colors of light from different directions, different intensities from different directions, and not just, you know, direct light sources like spotlights, but light bouncing up from the ground or from the walls. Whenever you look at something and it's not black, then there's light coming from it, it's hitting your face, and it's part of what's illuminating you. All of the indirect light makes a big difference too. So if you happen to have recorded a spherical image of the incident light, of the lighting that's in a particular environment, so this is some light from San Francisco's Grace Cathedral that has pretty colors coming from different directions, and you sample it out into the same, you know, spherical space that all of your reflectance images come in, you can multiply the illumination times the reflectance and then actually get a rendering of what the thing would look like in that illumination. And in this image-based way, that means that you take those images of the headdress lit from all the different directions, you color them in and adjust their brightness so that they're equivalent to the color and intensity of the light coming from all the directions in the environment. So those headdresses that are bright and yellow are bright and yellow because the light from those lighting directions was bright and yellow in the cathedral. And then if you add all of those images together, then it actually computes a image of what that headdress would look like under that illumination. And you can very quickly take maybe an outdoor, this is the Berkeley Eucalyptus Grove environment, and drop that illumination on. And that actually doesn't even require a three-dimensional model of the artifact. It's just a bunch of images that aren't that hard to take, and it's not all that much computation to just tint them all different colors and add them together. So we did this for a few artifacts for a paper we did a while ago. This is showing the capture in light stage two of the headdress. And we'll see the light spinning around. And once you animate the light on things, you actually get a better sense of its reflectance properties. You can tell that there's, you know, a little mirror that was stuck on here, which is probably a trade artifact bought from some of the settlers, and switch the lighting. I'll see if I can fast forward again and show a few more of these properties. This is a drum, which is interesting because it's a semi-translucent surface, and you can actually tell its translucency when you move the light behind it, and the paint on the front actually looks considerably different, whether it's front lit or back lit, and you can tell a bit difference about the different thicknesses here. This is showing a hat and an abalone necklace, which have some interesting reflections. And the clear thing that's a drawback here is you only have one view. It's not a full 3D model, so you can't move between. You could actually go a totally image-based way of changing viewpoint as well, which is if you simply took photos from lots of different directions, then you could morph between those different views. It's an early approach. So we actually rotated the headdress to a different position, shot that whole data set again, and then you can change the viewpoint virtually, again, without any 3D model, which is sort of hard for fur and feathers. And our idea was that eventually you could have an artifact in the center of something and light it from different directions, spin it every so often, and just have a bunch of cameras from the top to the bottom. And this would get an entire six-dimensional data set of every lighting direction and every viewing position that you could get. We also, you saw that styrofoam head we were putting some of these things on, and that felt a little bit silly because it kind of looks like an alien on that case. And we realized that the owner of these artifacts, who's an important member of the Native American community, Mr. George Randall, was available, and it was actually a much more interesting thing to document them with him wearing them. And the thing goes fast enough that you can record that, and now you have lighting control over a human face. And in fact, one of the main applications of our light stages these days is to record human faces in particular. This is light stage 5. It's the first one we built that had white LEDs in an entire sphere. And when a person's in there, yes, you can shoot it from every direction that light can come from. It ends up being not only a lot of data, but you have to stay still for quite a bit. And we eventually realized that a much more efficient process would be to not literally use every direction light can come from, but kind of break it down into basic frequencies of illumination. So like one lighting condition we'll get, we just turn all the lights on. And then some other ones we have like blurry light from the top, blurry light from the side, blurry light from the front. And these end up being useful lighting conditions for figuring out how the light is playing off of a surface, particularly if you're able to separate the two kinds of reflectance that you tend to get off of surfaces. When light hits a surface, some of the light will just reflect directly off of the surface, and we call that the specular reflection or the shine or the highlights that you'd see on something. And then other light can actually get into the surface, if it's a little bit translucent, bounce around inside and pick up the color of the surface usually, and then come back out, and that's called the subsurface scattering. And there's a useful thing about these that for a lot of surfaces, if you have polarized light, the specular reflection will keep it polarized, but the subsurface scattering, particularly inside skin, will depolarize the light. So if you build a device where you put polarizers on all of your lights and polarizers on your camera, and don't worry, she didn't break out in a terrible pox or anything. These are little eyebrow pencil marks we put on our actress, Emily, in case she moved during the performance here. But this is her lit from every direction light can come from, so she has a very flat image of illumination on her. But you'll notice she has no specular shine to her skin. You can even look in her eyes, and even though she's surrounded by all these little lights, you don't even see a specular reflection. And that's because we've tuned out all of the specular reflections by putting the polarizing filters on the lights at just the right angle that the light ends up reflecting polarized vertically toward our camera, so we can block it with a horizontal polarizer there. And the subsurface reflection, which involves her, you know, skin colors and the things that, you know, the melanin and the hemoglobin that give it skin color, and the diffuse light that comes out is depolarized, so it still gets through the camera. The cool thing is you can quickly flip the switch on the polarizer on the camera and then bring the specular reflection back in. And so these two images show with and without specular reflections. And if you calculate the difference between these two images, you get an image of just the specular shine of her skin from the whole sphere of illumination at the same time as well. And if you're trying to digitize a face, these are two very useful images to have, a flat-lit diffuse reflection image and a flat-lit specular image. And even more importantly, the light from the specular reflection hasn't gotten into the surface and it hasn't blurred out. So it's our best record of all the details of the surface shape that we can get. You can actually make out a lot more about her skin pores and her fine creases and all the stuff that gives her a human-like skin appearance. And if you look at how the light plays over the specular reflection lit from these different directions, you'll see that it actually reveals a lot about facial shape. And by using a combination of photogrammetry from different views of the face and the data that you get from analyzing the specular reflections and seeing where the principal directions of light are coming from that are reflecting toward the camera, you can get a hybrid model that doesn't just have the basic shape of the face, but also has a great deal of surface detail, which hopefully you can make out in this image, and you can see the skin pores and the creases. And this process is pretty fast. It takes about 2 seconds these days with our Canon 1DX cameras. And as a result, we can get 30 different facial expressions and create an animated version of a person with realistic reflectance properties. And that's something that we did for something called the Digital Emily Project, which was done in collaboration with Image Metrics in 2008, trying to create a realistic looking human face. And these are results. So that's actually a digital face right there of Emily. The eyes, the teeth, and the lips are all digital. The hair is real. We just replaced her face from some live video. Her body's real, but we'll show you which parts have been replaced. So that's the diffuse reflection on its own. The specular looks a little funny. But that shows all the crinkles and wrinkles of somebody's face. And then the underlying geometric mesh is there. Too. And that was an exciting thing to be able to do back in 2008 because nobody had done a realistic looking digital human at that scale in computer graphics, and we'd been trying for quite a while. It was also exciting that at the time we were starting to use this polarized spherical gradient illumination technique to digitize some actors for films, and we actually had an opportunity to work on a small independent feature called Avatar, which as it turns out, they were doing all the motion capture filming with the actors like Zoe Saldana here in her motion capture suit, and they wore helmets that held cameras to get their facial performances. They were shooting that all less than a mile away from our institute. And it wasn't a big deal for the visual effects people, our friends over at Weta Digital, to bring over actresses like Zoe Saldana and quite a bit of the cast to get scanned in our light stage and get some of these maps of their faces. Now, they didn't show up, all of them, in human form in the movie. A lot of them turn into these blue Na'vi people from the planet Pandora. But as you'll notice, there's actually some resemblance between Neytiri here and Zoe, the actress who plays them. In fact, essentially everything from the cheekbones down is literally from the geometry of Zoe's own face, and the rest of it, as much as possible for this kind of creature, borrows from Zoe's own facial anatomy. And that was an intentional decision because we wanted the real performance of Zoe Saldana to read as well as possible into the face of Neytiri, otherwise we wouldn't have a fun-to-watch movie. We scanned a couple other people too, like Stephen Lang, who plays the bad guy. That was done for a digital human stunt double, so these are some of our models with the reflectance. And he doesn't have an avatar. When he has to do an action sequence, he usually gets into this amp suit device to put him on more of an even footing with them. And in this case here, he's totally digital. And when your entire jungle is modeled and rendered digitally, when all of your lighting is digital, when your amp suit is digital, when the light that's inside the cockpit of the amp suit is essentially coming in digital, it actually gets pretty hard to take like a green screen element of an actor and stick it in there and have it look like they're really there. And so, especially if you're shaking them around really fast, which you shouldn't do on the real actors. So having a digital double, which Weta was able to do in part from our data, helped. And we got Sam Worthington too. He was very patient as we figured out which transistor wasn't quite seated properly there. And if he remains a big motion picture star for the next 25 years and never needs to play a younger version of himself, then this data fortunately exists. That got used in part to help create Jake Sully, for example. and also in some other shots where you might not have realized we're using as much computer graphics as they were. In this shot, obviously, Neytiri is a digital character. Sam Worthington is also completely digital in this shot as well. And the reason that the filmmakers decided to use a digital double for him is that Neytiri leans down and kisses him. And there's a lot of lighting interaction between the faces. She casts a shadow on him. He's bouncing some pink light onto her. She's bouncing some blue light onto him. He has various bioluminescent materials creeping up his neck and his ears that are lighting him from other directions. And if he's a digital asset, then you can just simulate this all in the computer, tweak it until it looks just right, and get a shot that really looks like that digital person is part of this real-world environment. And in this case here, they did a pretty convincing job. So this technique of using the light stage and the polarization and 156 or 300 lights around somebody seemed like a good way of digitizing human faces. So we can think about it, does it help us with this problem of artifacts that we might want to digitize? And it maybe helps a little bit, but there's a couple of problems, one of which is that artifacts can get really, really shiny. And if you put a really shiny thing in our light stage and there's just all this discrete illumination, you don't have great reflections off of it that are particularly helpful to analyze. The discretization of the light is a little bit too much for these reflections. And another thing that happens with really reflective surfaces is that the reflections you see in them actually shift around as you view from different angles. And they're so shiny also that even if you use structured light scanning techniques like projecting light from a video projector on them, that's good for this diffuse ball. It's not very helpful at all for these shiny sunglasses because the light just reflects off and not in the direction of the camera. So because the reflections shift around, you can't take views from multiple angles and then figure out which pixels here correspond to which pixels here and stereo triangulate where the shape was, and that's kind of vexing. You'd really like to digitize this, and you don't necessarily want to have to go and give it a powder coating before you do it, because that'll also disguise all of the material properties. And if it's an important artifact, you don't want to get a bunch of stuff on it. So we had an idea of trying to build a light stage that would provide continuous illumination around an object. And we did this by creating a semicircular arm, kind of like light stage 2, but the whole thing lights up at the same time. It's got 105 LEDs which are controllable, and the cameras on the right take long exposure photos, a whole second of an entire rotation. And as a result, as we change the colors and intensities, or the intensities of the LEDs as it goes around, we can create arbitrary spherical illumination patterns that are perfectly continuous that show up in our cameras when we take that 1 second exposure. And the lighting patterns that we chose were the spherical harmonics. It's basically low frequency illumination where it's like we just turn on the whole thing and then we just have very blurry gradients of light, eventually to higher and higher numbers of wiggles and wobbles of the illumination as it goes around, higher and higher frequencies. And if you look at how that reflects off of a shiny object, you can see that the different kinds of materials that are in the object respond differently to different frequencies of illumination. And the upshot is that after a little bit of mathematics, we can actually separate out, without using polarization, which affects thin film surfaces in kind of weird ways. It works great for faces, but probably not for sunglasses. We can actually get pretty efficiently from not that many photographs a nice per pixel record of the specular reflectance color of our artifact, of the diffuse reflectance color of our artifact. We can get per pixel a idea of how shiny it is based on how strong its reflection remains into higher and higher frequencies of illumination. So here we're showing the lenses are black because they're basically perfectly shiny. You can see a reflection in them. The frames of the glasses are kind of intermediate between being perfectly diffuse and perfectly shiny. It's kind of a glossy, rough specular reflection. And then this cylinder that they're mounted on is pretty diffuse, so that shows up as the highest surface roughness. And also by analyzing the specular reflection, we can come up with an estimate of the surface orientation of every part of the glasses, which becomes very important because now we effectively can put this smoothly varying view-independent texture onto the lenses, which now we can do stereo 3D reconstruction because we've essentially painted a map on here that we can correspond between different views. And when we do a combination of stereo reconstruction and the surface orientation that we get from lighting it from different directions, we can get a pretty good 3D model of these glasses that preserves the basic shape and then also details like this little logo that's embossed in here. And when we use all of those maps, it's actually not that hard to do real-time rendering. This could run in a web browser as well that has the measured specular reflection, surface gloss maps, and diffuse reflection, and light it with the lighting environment of your choice. This happens to be some light that I captured in the Galleria degli Uffizi in Florence. And here's another object, which has kind of a glossy metal satin kind of reflection there. And you can change the viewpoint. It also has what are called anisotropic reflection properties, which are what's happened when you get brushed metal and it spreads light in one direction upon reflection, but keeps it relatively focused in another. And here's something that's a little bit more like an artifact. It's just a tourist souvenir, but it has a specular reflection everywhere. And this is not, you know, just added on choosing what we think the shiniest was, it was actually measured per pixel everywhere on the object. So could this, you know, scale up? You know, this is one vision of how we might be scanning objects in the future in a more industrial way. If we don't want to have to move the objects around, you could have robot arms that do various things of aiming video projector light from different directions. And maybe instead of the swinging arm, you could just do it one piece of the sphere at a time with a big plasma monitor that could go around. So the final thing I wanted to talk about is that digitization is about preserving the stories of a civilization or a culture or of a person. And this can actually be taken very literally. Some of the most important stories that are out there are stories of the survivors of the Holocaust, and these people are at this point getting quite old. And even though a lot of them, such as Pinchas Gutter here, who was in a concentration camp in Poland when he was a teenager, does spend a lot of time going to schools and auditoriums speaking about his experiences, making sure that we don't forget. He probably will not be doing that in 10 or 20 years, unfortunately. The University of Southern California's Shoah Foundation Institute has been dedicated since the 1990s in preserving the stories of the survivors of the Holocaust. And we've been very happy to work with them in our own natural language group to try to record these in a way that they might be able to be recorded three-dimensionally. This is Pinchas Gutter in one of our largest light stages we call Light Stage 6. And he was interviewed while we were filming him with high-speed video. And at a rate faster than anyone can even notice, we're actually changing the lighting directions on him very quickly, which gives us the result of relighting the video after the fact. We actually get a record of his surface shape as he's being interviewed. We get color, surface orientation. We get a little bit of, like, you can tell his shoes are shinier than the clothing that he's wearing. And then we can relight him with the light from other different environments and even see, like, the glints off of his buttons when we do that. And of course, in addition, we would naturally record him from lots of different viewpoints and interpolate between those so we can then produce any viewpoint. So what I have here is just, this is all faked with visual effects, an idea of what we might be able to accomplish if we could create sort of like a holographic display that could be brought to a classroom. Students could ask questions of this hologram shown life size and rendered in the right lighting for that classroom. And thing would be auto stereoscopic, you wouldn't need 3D glasses, and everybody in the room would get their own appropriate point of view.
Do you remember any songs from your youth?
This is a lullaby that my mother used to sing to me, and I still remember it. It's in Polish. Jadą dzieci, jadą drogą, siostrzyczka i brat, i nawidzić się nie mogą. Jaki piękny świat.
So we were actually using our technology to render the different views as the camera moves across, but the 3D display didn't really exist. But we're working on that too, and what we tried to indicate is that, just with those LEDs behind there, there might be an array of lots of miniature video projectors projecting onto the screen different viewpoints of Pinchas Gutter. And in fact, we've gone so far as to build that. Here's 72 little video projectors. This is only big enough to show a face. These are two of our graduate students, Andrew Jones and Koki Nagano. And as you can see, by projecting different views of a person's face from all these different directions, you can actually create a glasses-free, kind of floating, three-dimensional image that looks like it's the right perspective and life size. And it's pretty straightforward just to get more video projectors and a bigger screen and scale that up. So that's the stuff that we've been working on. I'd like to thank a lot of the collaborators that we have, and there's two websites down there if you want to follow up with any of this. And thanks very much to the Smithsonian for putting on this event.